I'm Bill McWilliam, president of Cascadero Copper, CCD on the TSX Venture Exchange. Cesium is one of the world's rarest metals with a growing industrial demand. Drilling is underway on our Tehran property in Argentina to prove up a cesium resource. Cascadero's patent-pending leach process has the potential to make Cascadero the lowest-cost supplier of cesium in the world. Visit our website, cascadero.com, or phone us at 604-924-5504.
You're listening to HowStreet.com Radio, available online at talkdigitalnetwork.com. Welcome to HowStreet.com Radio, the online source for market opinions. Here is Jim Goddard.
My guest is Christopher Mulan. His website is thegoldandoilguy.com. Welcome back to the show, Chris.
Thanks for having me, Jim.
On the equity markets, an up day in Canada, a down day in the U.S., what's driving the markets today?
Yeah, well, if you look at what's kind of moving, Canadian markets are moving up a little bit today because of a couple key things. The gold miner sector and gold-related stocks, they're all having a nice jump today. And I think that's kind of on the back of a falling dollar and falling yield, long-term yields. And, of course, we've also got crude oil moving up, and one of the strongest sectors right now is actually energy stocks, which are up. The whole sector in general is up over 1% today, which is substantial considering pretty much every other sector is in the red. So Canada is definitely having a nice easy day, being heavy in the two kind of leading sectors for the day.
Well, the Canadian dollar did react positively to the oil price jump. Can we expect oil to increase in price over the next short term?
Yeah, crude oil is flirting here at a short-term support zone. It's having a little bit of a bounce today, up about 1.5%, but overall, it does have quite a bit of downward pressure. It's been in a downtrend for the last couple of weeks. It's in a longer term, pretty much since January this year. It's kind of in a falling channel, and then right now it's right in the middle of that channel. So in the grand scheme of things, crude oil is pretty neutral where it is. I do feel as though we could see it squeeze a little bit lower, drop down to around the $46-$45 per barrel over the next few days. But other than that, I do feel as though it's going to be lingering around this $48-$49 per barrel for probably a couple of weeks here.
Any fears that some analysts have said it could drop back into the upper 20s again?
You know, the longer-term chart of crude oil, it's trying to put in a major basing formation. It looks like it put in a major double bottom back in 2016 in January, February. But if it does continue to break down from this level and we see it close below more or less the $44 per barrel mark, that could trigger a massive wave of selling. And the technicals show that we would... The first big drop would bring us right down, I think, to about $35, $36 per barrel, which is a significant drop. And depending how that support level holds, there is very good potential that it could end up winding and kind of drifting lower and to test that $27 per barrel type 26 that we saw a long time ago. Now, that's looking forward multiple months. That's looking for the end of this year, potentially early 18. So I don't see that happening imminently, but there is potential. This long-term, it's actually about a 3.5-year pattern that is forming. Crude oil could kind of become fairly dormant and slowly just oscillate and grind its way lower all the way down to that 2026 level that we saw and put in a new low and put in a major bottom after that. That would be a very signature-looking pattern. Obviously, it's very long term. That would take probably another 6-8 months to play out. But it is possible, and I've seen this pattern unfold many times before on the charts, where it will just kind of fall out of favor and keep drifting lower longer than most people anticipate, and actually push to a new multi-year low nominally before it actually reverses and starts a new bull market.
What about oil services companies?
I follow the energy sector, not so much just the oil services. So I'm not sure how they would react, but obviously the energy sector stocks in general, which do encompass those stocks, they've just been out of favor. They've really, since December, they've just faded lower and lower, completely out of favor. They're trading at a critical support zone right now, that whole sector, that if it breaks this level, then it could be a leading indicator that crude oil could be heading much, much lower. Because right now, energy stocks have been pretty much leading the way for crude oil lower. And both of them are trading at a really critical level here that if they break down, things could get pretty ugly for the energy sector.
Of course, Saudi Arabia started the whole oil price war hoping to squeeze American frackers out of the business. They didn't do that. Do you think they're regretting their effort to drive down oil originally?
Yeah, you know, they could be. The long game for them is they want to squeeze everyone out and then see crude oil prices kind of pop back up and have nice lofty profits for them. So, you know, they usually look out pretty long term. I could still see it working out for them. If prices continue to drift lower and get back into that low 30 area, you know, it could play out and the frackers could squeeze right out for a while. And then we could see a knee-jerk reaction in crude oil. That's a long-term game plan that they're doing. I think they're looking forward 5 years or so for that whole scenario to kind of play out and really benefit them.
Unfortunately for them, I believe the technology that's involved in fracking improves every day and becomes more efficient. No one, you know, predicted a few years ago that they'd be able to drill sideways for several kilometers.
I know. Yeah, it really is incredible what they can do. And it's good and bad in many different ways.
We'll have more with Christopher Mullen right after the break.
Gem International is a new diamond explorer in the richest diamond-producing country in Africa, located next to the fourth largest producing diamond mine in the world. International Spotlight is on an 1,109-carat diamond recently discovered in Africa by a fellow Canadian junior. With a proven operator and finance team, Gem International trades on the TSX Venture Exchange, symbol GI. Visit us at gemdiamondmining.com.
Lotus Ventures Inc. is a BC-based medical marijuana company poised to launch into the rapidly evolving cannabis sector. Lotus is in the final review stage of the Health Canada approvals to become a licensed producer, having arranged facility financing of up to $12 million, plus building permits for its prototype indoor production facility. Shares trade under the symbol J on the Canadian Securities Exchange. Visit our website at lotusventures.ca.
Welcome back. We're chatting with Christopher Mullen. Chris, getting back to gold miners, are people looking at geopolitics when they invest in gold? Where are the gold mines if they're going to get into gold miners?
Yeah, you know, I think the hardcore investors who do their due diligence, I know for sure they look in to see where the companies are located, what states, what country, you know, what provinces. You know, they look right into that because there's a lot of regulations that are constantly changing and in most cases getting tighter and tougher to mine, and which increase costs or completely eliminate the being able to even mine an area. So it does play a big role, and that's where I think finding companies with top leadership who understand that and who have their foot on the ground and are communicating with where they're working and they do their research before they get too heavily involved is the key. So obviously, you've got a lot of little junior miners. They get into these, more or less, they're holding these giant properties with potentially nothing in the ground, and then they run into all kinds of problems when they start wanting to get into mining. Even if they find some traces of metals, once they get rolling, they realize that, you know, it's not even feasible. Once they do their studies, that there's just too many regulations, too many costs. You got to pay off certain people or natives in many different cases have rights to the properties. And so it makes a huge difference, geopolitics, what's going on, who's in control of the countries that's taking place, because it definitely does, it can either make a stock a huge success or just drive it into the ground and completely disintegrate.
Now, I know in the past Canada has been looked as a stable place to do business, but with the Green NDP coalition government probable and possible in British Columbia, what's that doing to people who might be thinking about investing in natural resources in BC?
Yeah, well, obviously, it definitely makes you think twice. Makes you think twice about maybe how much you want to put at play. I know, for an example, over in Quebec, which is there's a lot of gold mining there. They changed some rules last year. I had a friend there who has several different claims, and he used to go and be in the river and pan for gold and dredge for gold, and they changed some rules, and you're not allowed to do any mining within 60 feet of the river now. And he's like, it's completely useless. So he let his claims lapse this spring because, you know, you kind of want to be near the water, and he used it for many things, and they just said it's so strict that it just doesn't make it work anymore. And, you know, it's when it's tougher to mine, it also means that it's the metals become more valuable because it's harder, obviously, to produce more, and there's more costs involved in many cases. So in the grand scheme of things, tighter rules, I think, probably means for higher gold prices. It just also means you've got to be very careful with where you're investing, which companies and where they're mining.
Right. And of course, sometimes too, you have these impromptu strikes in places like Argentina or Chile that you didn't expect and no one could.
Yeah. Yeah, there's always the wild card. You know, that's, it really comes with any business or, you know, any sector. There's always going to be a wild card of some new regulation or breakthrough in technology that can completely change the outlook in a blink of an eye.
So are there concerns, as far as you know, in the mining sector that perhaps Canada is going to move out of a favored investment area into third world class?
I don't see it being that way. You know, I see things maybe getting a little tougher, and every year things always do get a little tougher for mining in general. But I still see Canada as being favored, as it's a very strong country for mining, and you know, I don't see it really hurting it too much at this point.
We'll have more with Christopher Mullen right after the break.
I'm Brian Fowler, president of Blind Creek Resources Limited, listed on the TSX Venture Exchange, ticker symbol BCK. Blind Creek is focused in the Yukon, Northwest Territories, and British Columbia. The company's key property is the Blend Project, one of the largest undeveloped lead-zinc silver deposits in Western Canada, plus plans to advance the recently acquired, fully permitted historic Engineer Gold Mine in the Atlin District of Northwestern BC. Check us out at blindcreekresources.com.
Keep informed. Receive our weekly recap of thought-provoking articles, podcasts, and radio delivered to your inbox for free. Sign up for the HowStreet.com weekly recap on our homepage, HowStreet.com.
Welcome back. We're speaking with Christopher Mullen. Chris, how are the equity markets doing, and where are people putting their money, and where are they pulling it out?
Right, yeah, the equities market, you know, money's been flowing into technology sector hand over fist. You know, you look at the NASDAQ, it's been on a tear. It's up the most, about 26 or 27% over the last year versus, you know, the S&P 500, which is up half that, if even half that. So money has been definitely flowing into tech. And, you know, in the grand scheme of things, we haven't seen a whole lot of big follow through in some of the major markets that you'd anticipate would be outperforming. Like financials typically are a big portion of a bull market run. And if you look at the XLF, it's been forming this very sideways channel and pattern that you could argue is a head and shoulders topping formation. And if it breaks to the downside, we are going to see financial stocks sell off very sharply, probably go back to test the prices we saw last November before Trump got in. And, you know, it kind of looks as though that could potentially happen. We've got longer-term yields are falling, and that's not good on the bank stocks. So that definitely is an area of concern to watch, the XLF. If it breaks down, it's probably going to pull most of the financial market with it. And the other sector, or the other area of stocks, are the small-cap stocks. They have also been trading sideways since December, and if they break out of this range, whichever way they break out of this range, whether it's to the upside or the downside, it's going to have a significant move. And at this point, it's showing that we should break to the upside. We've got some big money starting to move into small cap stocks. They're starting to come back to life. They've been, you know, out of favor for 7 months, more or less. And once they do break, they're going to really kind of kickstart the market to run higher. So it's going to be really interesting to see how these two major sectors play out going forward. Small cap stocks could actually be in favor while financials actually fall out of favor. And if you look at the broad market as a whole, like the S&P 500, it might not actually move up too much, yet the small cap sector could just explode and rally. So there's going to be hot pockets, and that's kind of the way to start to trade this market is find the hottest sectors or the hottest index and stick with it. And as it shows signs of tiring, you know, you can start to rotate out of those plays and look for some fresh new opportunities.
In other words, maybe people should be keeping a better eye on the Russell 2000 than they do to the big board or big boards.
Yeah, exactly. You know, the Russell 2000 is really good visual of what your trading account or your long-term investments are probably doing. A lot of people have a lot of speculative plays because they see better returns when they move into hedge funds or mutual funds. So they picked a little bit more aggressive plays. Well, those more aggressive funds hold a lot of these small and mid caps. And while the S&P 500 or the NASDAQ has been rising, they're seeing their fund go absolutely nowhere. And that's because they're holding all these higher speculative stocks that have been moving sideways for the last 7 months. So, you know, once this breaks out, the majority of people will actually start seeing their trading accounts or their long-term investments start to really pick up speed. And if it breaks down, then, you know, obviously it's the opposite story. They should be looking to potentially move out of small caps because small caps move extremely fast. And when they start to fall, it's a pretty slippery slope.
So a nice bump then, but if things go, I was going to say sideways, but obviously sideways isn't the right term here. When things start to go down, they really get sucked down?
Yeah, you got to be really careful when you're playing the small cap stocks. But again, at this point, everything is set to break and run higher. So that's kind of where I think the momentum is right now. And I think long equities is still the play for the next month or two.
Chris, thank you so much for chatting with us.
Always a pleasure, Jim. Thanks for having me on the show.
My guest has been Christopher Mulan. His website, thegoldandoilguy.com. You're listening to HowStreet.com Radio. Find us on Twitter at Talk Digital Net, our YouTube channel, Talk Digital Network. Questions for the show can be sent to info@HowStreet.com. I'm Jim Goddard. Thanks for listening.
Comments made on HowStreet.com Radio are an expression of opinion only and should not be construed in any matter whatsoever as recommendations to buy or sell any financial instrument at any time. Available online at TalkDigitalNetwork.com, HowStreet.com Radio is a production of HowStreet Media Incorporated.